You can call it, but you can't use my phone.
This is the RETROSCOPE podcast. I am BG the 27 kid,
and I'm Simone the Sharp Peacock.
And we're back once again. It's Monday morning, and we're here doing what we love to do most: is give you the breakdown on what's happening in the world, in the United States of America, and abroad. Simone, this is a weekend of graduations. Colleges and universities across the country were celebrating their commencement exercises, thousands and thousands of young people receiving degrees and certifications to go out into what we call the real world. Do you remember your graduation day?
No, because I didn't walk.
Wah,
I just killed that, right? Like, I just killed
from the illustrious Tuskegee University. She didn't walk.
I didn't walk. I was one of those students that got burned out because I started off in engineering, chemical engineering, and I was so ambitious and over the top when I was a freshman, so I was going to double in chemical engineering and chemistry and took all these chemistry classes and pushed hard and got to the point where I was really considering dropping out because
I had worked yourself.
Yeah, I had been there for so long, but I ended up being able to go. I had the credits for my chemistry degree, and right. I just said, all right, peace.
Graduated with no pomp and circumstance. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? I don't regret it, but that's me. You know what I mean?
Well, that was going to be my question. Do you look back and be like, dog, I should have walked?
Nah.
You don't feel like that?
No, nope, yeah. That's just not in my nature, though. And then, you know, I'm very fortunate, and I kind of assume your family's probably the same way. There are a lot of college graduates in my family.
Mm-hmm.
And like my younger sister graduated college a few years ago. I have a cousin that graduated from West Point, one from Yale, one from Montevallo. So, you know what I mean? It's kind of the norm.
The norm.
So it was never anything that was
blown up that you just had to do because
yeah,
people had been through it before.
And then I'm the oldest, like all the nieces and nephews, siblings, all of that.
Yeah.
And, The cousin that's closest in age to me is 6 years younger. So everything that I did was, you know, it's like, well, you need to walk. You need to do this. You need to do that. And I'm like, no, I just want to go. I just want to be done with it.
That's fitting, though. That's you staying true to you because you're not really like that anyway. So in a way, that does not surprise me because you kind of laid back and like, whatever, what on to the next situation. And I guess once you get to a certain point, as far as colleges goes, you don't remember it anyway. Like, I mean, yeah. I vaguely remember graduation, but it wasn't all that. But that's just our personal experience. There were a lot of excited parents, family members there celebrating with the young people. So to all the graduates out there and parents and aunts and uncles and cousins of graduates, congratulations. And we wish you the most success as you enter into the workforce. It's been another interesting week. And what we do on this show here is we just recap the past week's headlines, the news, and we make it our point to give you our opinion and our perspective on what we think is going on, right or wrong. Some people like it, some people hate it, but either way, we feel like we are inclined to do so. So let's get into some of these national stories, starting off with Miss Ayesha Curry. This is the wife of last year's NBA MVP, Stephon Curry, of the Golden State Warriors. They're having another phenomenal season. And this couple has become a very popular couple in the national eye. Wouldn't you say so?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know, everywhere you go, Instagram, Facebook, you're seeing little short videos and stuff of them and their family life and their babies and how they relate. And so they've kind of become like this model young African-American couple.
Mm-hmm.
They seem to have the very, I guess, religious based. They seem to do everything the right way, quote unquote.
Mm-hmm.
On last week, Miss Curry, she took to Twitter, and she actually has been pretty active on Twitter. She's a chef, so she does a lot of posting about food and different stuff. But on this particular one, she made some statements about style and fashion. and the statements on style and fashion were really geared towards what the trend is now with a lot of the fashion being more revealing, I guess more sexually forward. And her actual statement was, "Everyone's into barely wearing clothes these days. Not my style. I like to keep the good stuff covered up for the one who matters." Now, as a guy, we kind of go either way with that. But before I get into what my thoughts are, Simone,
mm-hmm.
you are a woman.
Mm-hmm.
You are a very progressive woman, and you're all about women being respected and seen in the proper light and with the proper esteem. When you hear a statement like that, knowing everything that you know, how did that make you feel?
It didn't make me feel any kind of way. I mean, the truth of the matter is Aisha Curry and her husband have been known as, like you said, kind of that couple that do things the right way. But when you just, like, the statement, I'm going to say the statement again because this poor girl got drugged.
Mm-hmm. They drugged her pretty bad. They jumped on it. Black Twitter went ham.
You know what I'm saying? Everyone's into barely wearing clothes these days, hun. Not my style. I like to keep the good stuff covered up for the one who matters. And then there's a following tweet.
Right.
When she said, just looking at the latest fashion trends, I'll take classy over trendy any day of the week. Now, I can see how that seems a little bit loaded because, you know, she said, I'll take classy. But she didn't say classy over trashy. She said classy over trendy. I guess just me personally, I didn't take it that seriously. It's like, you know, that's a personal preference of hers. And she stated what her preference is. That's not to say that the way that another person dresses or if there's someone that is more revealing in their attire, it doesn't mean that they need to be respected less automatically, you know. But as far as her statements are concerned, I'm super duper progressive about stuff like this. Mm-hmm. But what she said wasn't that serious. Like I said, she got drug. Drug.
And I saw the commentary on her comments and the opinions on how people felt about them before I even got an opportunity to actually read what she said. And I mean, just based off of the comments, it sounded like she had really stepped out there and stepped on somebody's toes and really made like a direct statement that somebody was dropping the ball or putting themselves in a disrespectful position. But then when I looked at it, it's just purely her personal opinion. I like to keep the good stuff covered up for the one who matters. So I couldn't really figure out why people took so much offense to it. But then in going further, there have been a lot of different blogs and stuff talking about it. Ran across one in Ebony that talked about the respectability politics of Aisha Curry. So, you know, in the black community, we always hear this thing about being respectable, or this respectability is it relates to you have to position yourself in a certain kind of way to be accepted in the mainstream.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so for this it's like, okay, well, by saying that you would rather take classy over trendy or talking about people not wearing clothes for those women that choose to be more revealing in their dress, the presumption is that by making this statement, you're saying that they are to be disrespected or they are not living up to that certain standard of respectability because they choose to present in a different kind of way, which I guess could be taken either way. At the end of the day, it's what you decide to do. If you feel like you want to wear less clothes, you want to be naked, then be naked. If you want to wear clothes, wear clothes. But don't be so caught off guard when people respond to you a certain kind of way. Now, as a man, right?
Mm-hmm.
I tell everybody, sight and sound. We sight and sound. So we respond heavily to what we see and what we hear. Now, I'm pretty decent. I can pretty much see a person for who a person is and get into conversation without being judgmental. I can do that.
I agree
with
that.
But if you come to me and I don't really know you and you naked, now my first thought is going to be, what is this nakedness about?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to be thinking about something totally different than what your what your mind state is, what your conversation like. I'm now in a physical mind state, and that could be my own fault, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you choose to do that, then you've got to know that there's a possibility that there might be somebody out there like me that's not going to be caring about your mind. At that moment in time, I'm going to care about what you're presenting on the table.
Well, I mean, but that's the thing. Like, we are in a state of such heightened, everybody's radar for microaggressions and micro tensions and all that stuff are so finely tuned that when anybody says anything that makes reference to gender or race or any of the buzzwords, right? People react to that. And what she said to me is simply her opinion. But look at how far that just went. Like, you just talking about, like, as a guy, this is what I'm going to think. When the truth is, all she said is, this is how I choose to dress. And then it opens up these, like, millions of conversations about any and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
And you end up losing sight of she just stated her opinion.
Opinion.
That's it. She just
made an opinion of how she felt.
She was looking through a magazine.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. But that's a whole nother thing that we'll probably talk about in episode after episode about how I feel like that and that response that you're talking about is correlating to just social media and the access and the platform that social media gives people. So we all want to be right, and we all want to push culture and push opinion. So anytime something like that comes up, then it's an opportunity for us to debate and show how we can be right in this particular life.
Yeah, because there are millions and millions of intelligent, witty, smart, on the money people. And when you have 140 characters that you can just put out there immediately, the minute you have a thought, that can be a dangerous thing. It can be a great thing. Like, you know, they were talking about Black Twitter drug this girl, but Black Twitter be coming through on some other topics.
It does. It makes stuff happen.
So, you know, it's just, I think the thing is we keep, and I'm going to say this almost every episode, is using the term intersectional thinking. It's really difficult to think intersectionally on a conscious level because it's something you just live, you know what I mean? Right. And you just experience it. But when you start having all this rhetoric and all these people with these opinions, and you know, everybody got a column, everybody got a podcast, like,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, when you have all these outlets, it's hard but necessary to become more discerning, mm-hmm, about what topics you're going to focus on and how you're going to approach them, because everything that we talk about has multiple dimensions to it. So it's just like you kind of have to pick one
and ride with it.
But when you have millions and billions of people with access to 3, 4, 5 social media platforms who have not come together and conferred, because let's be real, we call it Black Twitter, but Black Twitter is made up of very intelligent individuals.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They might catch on to the hashtag, but it's their individual opinions that are coming out. So it's not like there's going to be this big coalition of Twitter, Black Twitter summit, where we can discuss what we gonna focus on. So it's always going to be a little bit, off center, or a little bit out there.
It always can drift all the way low. As a woman,
mm-hmm,
are you conscious of what you're wearing to certain places? Are you thinking about how what you put on is going to affect other people? Is that a part of your process?
Not as much. The older I've gotten, not so much. When I was younger, I was one of those. I was a tomboy. Mm-hmm. But I was also very much driven by comfort. So I just wore whatever I wanted to wear. I was a tomboy. I played sports. But I can remember being in high school and, like, and you know about Birmingham, had city stages and Heritage Festival and all those summer festivals. And that was a pretty normal thing for, like, high school students to go out and hang out. And I would go every year. But the thing is, all the girls used to wear tank tops. And, like, and you know, that's not anything that's over the top or, overly exposed and all of that. But I remember being such a tomboy that I would get nervous about wearing, like, these little spaghetti straps. Just because it showed so much. It wasn't because I came from this uber conservative household. It wasn't like I was told, you know, it was that cover up for the man you love. It was none of that. That was just a very, like, specific thing. And then I got older and just got into style, like, you know, like the creative, the artist kind of kicked in. So it became more about what I just happened to like. So I always feel like I'm a little, my thinking about it is a little oblivious in some ways. Because it's not this, like, oh, super evolved, I'm above all this. You know, I'm not worried about it. Yeah, I have my moments where I worry about it, but a lot of it is just being a little bit oblivious to it and never really being told to dress any specific way or you supposed to cover up or, you know, I don't know. And then I don't even know if this is a word. I'm not judgmental. I was about to say unjudgmental. I don't know if that's a word, but.
None. We can make it a word.
Yeah. I made that up, judgmental. Y'all. Yeah. I'm not judgmental. So I have friends who would dress a little bit more revealing. You know what I mean? But I never thought anything of it. You know what I mean? I never thought anything of it. And then, you know, I'm also in the mind frame of as a for real adult, like in the last 3 to 4 years, I'm a big proponent in understanding that a woman's body is more than just something to look at. I understand the anatomy, the biology behind it, the necessity in it. You know, to make any reference to, like, you know, it's this thing right now where people are really getting serious about supporting women's rights to breastfeed in public.
Right.
And having 3 children of my own that I nursed, and it was just the common sense thing to do for me. You know, it's like, why are people getting so worked up about something that's just a natural thing?
I ain't gonna lie though, Simone.
Here we go.
I ain't gonna lie though, Simone. I had a classmate from high school. We grew up together. And she might even listen to this podcast. But she had a baby. This was about 2 or 3 years ago. And we was at dinner. We was at lunch, actually. And the baby was there. And so while we was eating, the baby feeding time came up. And now here is my longtime friend just plopping that thing out at the lunch table. I was a little taken aback. I was a little thrown off. I didn't know what to do at that moment. I was a tad bit uncomfortable, but non-judgmental. And that was kind of my first, introduction to this movement that you're talking about, and we kind of getting off. But yeah, I just had to throw that in there. I was a little bit.
But that's the thing. It's not a realistic expectation for people to not be unnerved by it or caught off guard by it. It's like, once you get over that, because we all are thrown off by something that we've never seen.
We're not used to, right?
Yeah. I mean, but it's like, once you get used to it, when you get enough boobies on Facebook.
Yeah, I'm ready, man.
You know what I'm saying, right? And pictures, because, you know, there are 4 Instagram accounts that support this movement. There are people that, you know, personally, you know, if you'll see them, you know, with their pictures and all of that, it's kind of like, it's time to get over it. Like, this is what it's going to be. People are going to keep doing that. And, but to kind of bring it back. Yeah. Like, my thinking has been, in some ways it may come across as oblivious. And then for me, I do think I really function from a place of, like, common sense and not common sense. Like, the next person is stupid. But common sense, like, 1 plus 1 equals 2, so what else is there to talk about? You know what I mean? Like, if it makes sense to do it this way, why is it such a debate?
Yeah.
And then the bottom line is everyone's choice is their own. So why is someone's personal choice that they can keep behind closed doors or within their relationship or whatever, why is it an issue for the next person?
But I do wonder if it really matters. Mm-hmm. You have a woman that might have on a short, tight skirt and just a bustier and everything is, for the most part, exposed, versus someone that might be, like, dressed up in a knee-length skirt or something that's more, you know, covered.
Mm-hmm.
Do they get different attention? Do they get a different response, i.e. from the opposite sex? And I have been in situations to where, like I was saying in the beginning, yes, like, you're drawing my attention. So if you're showing it to me, you're drawing my attention to this, to your physicality, just to the physical presentation, versus if somebody has on a little bit more and it's not revealed to me, then now I'm looking more so at, like, the other stuff first, like I'm really engaged in the conversation. So,
well, see, here's my thing, and I would challenge you or anybody else who says that a little bit. What it comes down to is you don't put that responsibility off onto that woman for you to decide how you're gonna approach her. You know what I'm saying? Like, you, and I'm not just saying you. Like, I ain't attacking you, BG. But
yeah, I'm still learning. The law is still working on me.
I mean, because it goes to. And this might seem harsh, but the truth is that's going to that victim blaming shit that everyone, man and woman, has to overcome, you know? And so that, to me, is a very low rung. That's sort of where that belief starts, where you blame like a rape victim. That starts with that little bit of a, well, you dress this way or you act this way, so you got this attention on yourself. But no, it shouldn't work that way. It's not supposed to be that way. That's where, you know, you get these movements where, you know, I'm sure you've seen, like, Lean In and, you know, talking about, it's a little bit of a feminist thing, I guess, and trying to get equal pay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, you know, like, you hear people say lean into this or lean into this cause, lean into that cause. And so Lean In has a lot to do or a lot to say about men who might label themselves as feminists or at least support equality for women and all of that. That's where that whole idea of Lean In comes in. It's like, that's on you to say, all right, she may not have any clothes on. And it ain't easy. I'm not, but maybe there may be some political reason she's doing that. There might be some well thought out reason she's doing that. Now, you could talk to her and you find out, no, it ain't nothing deep. That's just what she do. That's what she do.
Yeah.
And that's fine too. You know, but then you could be talking to somebody who is super intelligent, mm-hmm. has a cause. Mm-hmm. I'm giving away one of my secrets here, but you know, when I was starting, like, Shy Peacock and, like, trying to build a lot of, like, the marketing stuff and, like, getting used to Instagram, because, you know, it's image driven with Instagram. And, you know, like, some guy made some comment about my hair, and, you know, y'all, anybody who knows me knows my hair is usually big. I've been wearing it pulled up lately, but I wear it big and curly, so it draws attention. And, you know, I said something back to this guy who was like, oh, your hair is so this, and you look this way, and you look that way. And I was just like, well, you know what? If me being pretty is going to draw you in so I can teach you something, then so be it.
Mm-hmm.
And some women do have that mentality. Some women do understand how to make that work for them. It's like, oh, okay, I know that you don't get caught up on the visual, the aesthetic. Like you said, the sight and sound. But once you get to know me, I might blow your mind completely, you know, and have you doing whatever I want you to do.
For sure. So, yeah, so that's why I guess the importance of always operating in that no judgment zone, because you don't ever know. And she basically closed out the Twitter dialogue with a statement, regardless of if you like my style of clothes or not, parentheses, which I don't care, close them. please do not tear women down and degrade them. Mm-hmm. Not cool, peeps. So here we go. Round about it. It was an opinion. No judgment zone. Do what you feel. But, you know, don't get into, like I say, tearing people down and throwing these shots. Mm-hmm. That destroy what another person has going on. So a teachable moment for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
Next stories are a little bit more serious and some things that, like I was telling you earlier, is I'm kind of disappointed in the fact that we haven't been really engaged in these conversations about these particular issues earlier. But as we in our conversation, we also highlighted the fact that is the importance of us having this RETROSCOPE podcast and the other podcasts that we have in the network, is to jump on these things earlier and mm-hmm. to get them out to our listenership and put them on their mind at a much quicker rate than what we can expect from mass media outlets. So it's crazy how this stuff comes to my attention by way of hashtag on Instagram and Facebook. So I see this hashtag that says "Stay Mad Abby," and I see it continually. I see it on different posts on the timeline.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm trying to figure out, well, who is Abby? So here opens up the story about Abigail Fisher. Abigail Fisher is a young white girl who back in 2008 was denied admission into the University of Texas, Austin. And she sued the university because she felt that her denial to the university was based on race. She was discriminated against based off of race. And this has gone on. It started off, of course, at the local and state level and made its way all the way up to the Supreme Court. First time at the Supreme Court was in 2012. Mm-hmm. So this starts 2008. Makes an appearance in the Supreme Court in 2012, 5 years ago. But the court ruled against her. They ruled in favor of the university, stating that the university's admission processes were not discriminatory. There was no constitutional violation. It went back. 2013, went to the U.S. Court of Appeals in the circuit that she lives in. They ruled once again. They also ruled in favor of the university. She appealed that, and the appeal made it its way back to the Supreme Court, and they agreed to listen to it again. And this is where we are now. So it's over a 7-year span. This young lady has been fighting for admission into the university because she felt like she was kicked out because she was white. Go figure that. since that time, though, she's gone on. She went and got a degree from LSU, and she's out, and I think she's working now. So this is...
She's a financial analyst.
Yeah, she's a financial analyst in Austin, based off of our research, and she's working. And even to go further, I guess to really put this into perspective, all she wanted was damages for not being in a university, which totaled to be $100. But for some strange reason, the Supreme Court has agreed to go through this process again.
Mm-hmm.
Simone, young white girl can't get into UT. What say you about this?
So my hardcore white feminists need to come on into the picture. And,
I don't know. I don't think it's going to happen, Simone.
No. Let me finish. Sorry. Because this woman, in her stupidity, in her ignorance, and her backing by a racist former stockbroker, is being led down a path of trying to single-handedly dismantle affirmative action. And affirmative action, as we know, is supposed to benefit minorities and women, but...
Say that louder, because people throw around affirmative action and automatically it's thought to be beneficial to African-Americans.
But white women are the ones who benefit the most from affirmative action. So, like I said, my super hardcore feminist out there, you better go get your girl because she about to tear it down.
She's gonna mess it up.
And for something that she ain't even finna get, because the truth is, Supreme Court could, you know, they find in her favor. She doesn't get anything other than $100 if she gets that. Mm-hmm. She's not going to Texas. She got her degree from LSU. She wreaking havoc on Austin already.
But, This is more so that the guy that you talked about, the Bloom guy, he's a well-known conservative that is a part of he has an organization, a nonprofit organization. He graduated from UT, mm-hmm. and the organization is the Project on Fair Representation.
Let me stop you right there. You hear the name of that?
What?
The Project on Fair Representation.
You got a problem with that?
No, I have a problem with it, but that's the kind of name that will mislead people.
What's the problem with it though, Simone?
Project on Fair Representation. Okay. He's a conservative who has made it his practice to kick off cases like this. Mm-hmm. He spends his days organizing lawsuits to fight racial preferences and classifications, aka he is trying to shut affirmative action down. And he's doing it through a nonprofit with a safe name, which will give you the wrong impression.
The wrong impression. Believes over time that race-based policies violate every principle of equality they were created to uphold. Said that affirmative action treats whites, just whites, unfairly and stigmatizes minorities, and the rules that require certain, mostly southern states to obtain special federal permissions and stuff like this. These were his statements on the Voting Rights Act. So he was also pushing, funding the fight against the Voting Rights Act, Section 5, which affected us in Shelby County, Alabama, mm-hmm. to where the state or that particular county was trying to change the voting zonage
mm-hmm.
to basically positively affect the white votership. Mm-hmm. And we know that the southern states, the whole Section 5 was put in place because the southern states were doing all these different things to disenfranchise black people from voting. So these mm-hmm. things were necessary to keep them in check. So this, along with what you're saying with this Abigail case, are these collection of attacks on these standards that have been put in place to make sure that these states in this country treat people fairly and justly, and mm-hmm. there's equality across the board. So the question that some people will have, okay, well, what is UT's process? And I guess UT's process is probably reflective of a lot of institutions' way of going about enrolling and making sure that their diversity numbers are up and all that type of stuff. All right, so for UT, they got a top 10 program. Have mm-hmm. you seen this? Did you see that? About the top 10 program?
Mm-mm, mm-mm.
So they've got a top 10 program at UT. So students in Texas that graduate in the top 10% of their high school class mm-hmm. get automatic admission.
Okay.
So the year that Abigail was trying to get into UT, people in that top 10 program took up 92% of the in-state spots.
Mm.
So they don't leave 8% of in-state spots available. All right. So the next thing, if you don't fall in that top 10, the next step for application is using a two-element scoring system. So one of the elements they will look at will be your grades and test scores.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing they will look at is something that they call the Personal Achievement Index. So the Personal Achievement Index is made up of two essays. They look at your leadership stuff, activities, community service. They also look at special circumstances. And so some of the special circumstances would be things like your social economic status,
mm-hmm.
the type of home situation you come from,
mm-hmm.
language barriers. If you come from a home that English might not be the first language. And they also consider race in there.
Mm-hmm.
So where did Abby fall? Abby was not in the 10%. She was not in the top 10. She had a pretty decent GPA, 3.59, and an SAT score of 1180 is what they report, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you say, okay, well, she didn't get the top 10, but she was a pretty decent student, so maybe she should have been, given admission based off of the other parts of the scoring system.
Mm-hmm.
Noted, there were 168 Black and Latino students that had similar grades, good or better, that were also denied. So where is the race in that? Then the argument was like, okay, well, they do have provisional admission. So some students that don't meet these things provisionally get accepted.
Mm-hmm.
these students had like lower scores, and they actually had lower scores than, say, Abby and lower grades. Five black or Latino students were admitted under provisional status. Guess how many whites were admitted under provisional status?
How many?
42.
Okay.
Where's the race in this? In addition, they also have another thing. So if you don't make the scores, you don't make the top 10, they say, okay, well, if you go to another state institution for your freshman year,
mm-hmm.
get a GPA of 3.2, then you will be able to apply and be for admission and be admitted at UT for your sophomore year.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't want to do that. So where's the race issue? How serious was she about getting into UT if she really wasn't willing to go through the steps that they put in place to make sure that everybody has an opportunity to get admission?
This is
a crazy thing.
She just showed a blatant acknowledgement of her white privilege.
Truly.
I mean, and I'm not talking about just a perceived or superficial level of it. It's no, an ingrained, oh, I am entitled to this. I don't care what's rational. I don't care what's on paper and what the rules are and this thing, the system that can be tracked. I think I'm supposed to get in. So I feel so emboldened and empowered to sue you because you didn't let me in, even though I didn't meet any of the requirements. The thing about University of Texas Austin is there something like 51,000 students total.
Correct.
And only about 2,000 or 2,200 or something like that are black.
3.9%.
So Abby, honey.
45% white.
So you couldn't get one of them other thousands of spots. Because this is my thing about this Abigail chick. Stop blaming everybody else for your mediocre existence. Because apparently you perform from a mediocre place. Great, you have an 1,100 score. Great, you have a 3.5, whatever. Whatever the other requirements are, you didn't meet them. And when you couldn't meet them and you were given an opportunity to do something about it, you chose not to. You went to LSU. In LSU, it was like a Division I school or just it's considered. Yeah, I mean, it's considered.
It's parallel. It's right side by side.
Yeah, it's like, so you wanted a college education. You got one. Shut the hell up.
Yeah, but this is a play. Systematic. This is a systematic stratagem that is really being executed.
Mm-hmm.
If you just look at the timing of everything, you've got a very conservative Republican, damn near racist Congress in place. Mm-hmm. You've got one of the most conservative collection of Supreme Court justices in recent time. You've got all this energy and all this, I would just qualify it as neoconservatism. You got all this neoconservative energy that's circulating in our country right now. So now would be the time for someone who's trying to take us back to pre-Civil War to start throwing those shots,
mm-hmm.
to put this on the radar. And I'm just really perplexed on the fact that the Supreme Court would even agree to hear this again, provided just the little stuff that we've presented here today. Like, mm-hmm. and I'm sure they have more documentation and more discussion with experts that would totally, in my opinion, support the process that the University of Texas has in place. But for me, that whole conservative word is starting to mean, to me, something different, but it's probably meant the same thing to those conservatives the whole time. And it's this pre-emancipation, like I say, pre-Civil War thought about the way the country should be.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you look at it, what they're dismantling, what they're trying to take away are the amendments that were put into place to regulate this country, to regulate and make sure that all American citizens, everybody that was born here had an opportunity to justice and equality. Mm-hmm. And so when you start doing stuff like this and attacking affirmative action and attacking voting rights acts and civil rights acts and all that type of stuff, you're telling me that you wanted to go back to the old way. You're telling me that black lives don't matter. You're telling me all these things. That's what that means. And so I really feel like it's very important for us to know what the history is. I get into discussions and debates about history all the time. Like a lot of people say, you know, that's history and we don't need to deal in the history. We need to move forward. But the important things about history is that everybody else that we're competing against, they know the history. And the tactics that they use are based on that history. They're trying to get back to that. So the only way that you can really position yourself against that is to know what the moves are going to be. And this is it. This is really what it is.
And by nature, history repeats itself.
For sure.
It's just the bottom line. It's one of that's another one of those kind of that 1 + 1 = 2 things. It's like history repeats itself. The world moves in cycles. Nothing that happens is new. Nothing that takes place is new. It might present itself in different circumstances, but nothing is new. And now it's like it's time to start questioning some of the history that we have been taught and what we know of, because it's clear now, because people are literally challenging history books. People are not blindly going with what they say, i.e., Christopher Columbus is an evil person. That's just kind of the consensus. Like, nobody can deny it. You can't turn a blind eye to it. So people are starting to say it, which is why you have the emergence of Indigenous Peoples Day. Correct. Right? You know, like Thanksgiving, like, I know people are like, chill. You don't have to get like super political and passionate about Thanksgiving and all of that. But no, what's happening is history is not being glossed over and ignored anymore. You still have people living. You still have Native Americans who feel the scars of what happened to their ancestors, right? And you have, in combination with what you and I talk about all the time, a generation of people who are unafraid to speak up about it. Because it's just the truth as far as they're concerned. It's fact. So, you know, it's the history books that you and I were taught from are null and void. You know, they don't serve any real purpose.
They really don't.
You know, and it's getting to the point where people are asking these questions about it. Like, you know, so how, but back to the point I was making is like, history repeats itself. Everything moves in cycles. Everything that's hot now was hot before. You know what I mean? Everything that's considered lame now was lame before. And it made a turn back to being what's hot. So,
like we always say, you can expect more of this, because there is really, like I say, because of the way that the thing has timed out, they've been working this plan. Like, I think this plan has probably been at least 25 to 30 years in the making as it relates to locking down these positions, these political positions, and getting people in place so that when certain things come up, you've got everybody that's on a board with this agenda, they can make some things happen. So we really have to, we have to really start countering this. And something very disgruntling came out of this same case were the statements of Justice Antonin Scalia.
Mm-hmm.
Scalia is a justice that came in under the Reagan administration. So this guy's 70 years old, white guy. And he has really been.
All you had to say was Reagan.
True, but some of our listeners might not really be familiar with what that means. But he is, and he this ain't his. This is not his first time. But he made some very racially derogatory statement as it relates to this case, and he has been known to be on that side of being one of the more conservative justices in the Supreme Court. And his statement was, we always like to quote what they say, is that he's talking about schools and African-Americans going to school. And he said that there are those that contend that it does not benefit African-Americans to get them into the University of Texas, where they do not do well, as opposed to having them go to a less advanced school, a slower track school, where they do well.
Mm-hmm.
And that was like a shot heard across the world. I mean, of course, people have commented on that. Minority Leader Harry Reid from Nevada said that it's disturbing to hear a Supreme Court justice endorse racist ideas from the bench of the nation's highest court, and that Scalia's endorsement of racist theories has frightening ramifications, not the least of which is to undermine the academic achievements of African Americans. From the Supreme Court, you've got one of the justices that they rule on constitutional law all day long.
Mm-hmm.
This is what he's been doing for years, and he made that type of statement from the bench. When you see this, do you want to just like meet Scalia in a dark alley somewhere and kick him in the nuts?
No, I want to meet Clarence Thomas in the alley and kick him in the nuts, because he's sitting on that same Supreme Court probably shouting his boy out. Like, yep.
But he feel the same way.
Yeah. That's what I think of. It tells you where my mind goes. It's like, oh, okay, well, Scalia is just confirming what most of us already know. Because if you are a conservative, you're a 70-year-old white man, and you were put on the bench during Reaganomics, Reagan's administration. So for younger people who don't know, look that up. You'll understand. It's kind of like, to me, it's not surprising in the least. And I am a proponent for, please show me who you are so I know for the future. So he is saying exactly what a lot of these conservatives, pundits, justices, whoever, you got your Rush Limbaugh, your Bill O'Reilly, your Fox News, all of that. He's just representative of that whole class of thinking. So for me, it's not surprising in the least. And like, my mind goes to Clarence Thomas. It's like, oh, okay.
Man, never mind. But anyway, the door is opening. Like, it's open season. There's a certain degree of confidence and comfort that these people in these positions are getting, and they just forget their entitlement to the public, to all of us. They just saying whatever they feel like they can say and get all this stuff off of their chest.
But I mean, when you say they forget, do you think they even acknowledged it in the first place?
I think that in a certain environment, it's like that situation to where, say, like your workplace, you know, you've got that guy in there that's anti everything that's good. But if he's surrounded by a whole bunch of people that's like all about doing good, he ain't going to say too much.
Mm-hmm.
You'll know it, but it won't take him long to go back in the corner and keep that stuff to itself.
Mm-hmm.
But once he gets around his buddies, once they become the majority,
mm-hmm.
Oh, it's finna be bad on the other folks, because now he feel like he's backed up and he's supported by the numbers. So I think that's what's happening. What we're seeing is that there is this, I guess this feeling of, there's a lot of us on the same page. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of us that believe this. And so now we're finna let you know how we really feel.
Mm-hmm.
And you just gonna have to deal with it. You're just gonna have to deal with it. But once again, Black Twitter, Instagram, Facebook took to it. You saw a lot of people making it known for Abby and for Scalia that everything that they fighting about and everything that they're saying that Black people and African-American students and women should not have. They went to social media and let them know what they had accomplished. So you saw a lot of people posting their degrees and their graduation pictures and all this type of stuff with the hashtag Stay Mad Abby and # Scalia.
Uh-huh. You know, it just burns me up that these situations happen to where we have to respond with hashtags. You know, people have to respond with pictures of themselves in their cap and gowns and in their multiple degrees and all these achievements that are important achievements and they should be proud of and they should be able to post pictures about, but it should not have to be in response to some racist Supreme Court.
Stupid.
Yeah, some racist Supreme Court justice and some dumb chick who couldn't get into the school she wanted to get into who got mad about it. Mm. You know, like, it's ridiculous. Like, at some point, like, I love the hashtag. I like seeing these pictures. I have plenty of friends who posted pictures, you know, and it's a good feeling. to get that groundswell of showing that, yeah, black people are smart. We can do it. But now it's time to stop.
So where do we go from there, Simone? Like, if we stop that, then what should we move into? And we got to do something, right? We got to do something.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good starting point, but I'm speaking like specifically to this Stay Mad Abby thing. It's time to like wind that down, because what's happening is you see how these ultra conservative, and in my mind, ultra conservative today means ultra racist outlets are trying to turn that into reverse racism. And for anyone who needs to understand, I think it's not possible for black people to be racist to white people. I think you can be a black person and be racist to your own people. But, they need to get out of here with that.
I agree. I don't see how that's a possibility. You know, and the numbers objectively speak to this being retarded. But somebody must have seen something. So we're going to keep our eyes on it. Hopefully that the judgments and the rulings will be the appropriate and the correct ones. But we'll keep you all linked in to that. So that's our news for the previous week. Headline news. Make sure you make that a part of your daily conversations. Spread the word. Get information and educate yourself on what's going on so that you can talk against some of this stuff or talk in support and just elevate one another as it relates to current events and social issues and all such as that. Simone, it's that time. Time for our music mix. What you got for us today?
Okay, today we got Girl by the Internet. Prepared by my girl Jill Scott, and I Don't Really Care by Bilal. Hope y'all enjoy it.
Let's get into it. Be back.
I just wanna be free.
We are back. This is the RETROSCOPE podcast, the podcast you love. Well, culture, creativity, and conversation all come together. It's that time of the show where we get into our main topic of the day. We like to take some time to really get into some issue. And this one is really a big one as we move into the way that people are treated when we talk about the justice system. How we talk about some of the discrepancies and disenfranchisement in the justice system, but even deeper than the justice system, just socially, how people are treated and looked upon.
Said on Friday, December 11th, Daniel Holzclaw, a 29-year-old cop, well, he was 27 when he was initially accused of raping these 13 black women. He was found guilty on 18 of 36 counts of rape. Perpetrated against 13 black women, right? And apparently the person or the thing that broke the story was a 57-year-old grandmother by the name of Janie Liggins. Make sure I got her name right. Janie Liggins. Mm-hmm. You know, she was stopped and sexually assaulted, abused, and a number of other things by this police officer. And right after it happened, she and her daughter immediately went to the police and reported it. And from there, the investigation started. And that's where they found the other women. The reason I point that out is Miss Liggins is considered a upper middle class black woman, no criminal record, no history with the police. And in a lot of ways, someone that society would say wouldn't have deserved that treatment. By contrast, the other women involved all had some sort of issue with the law, whether it's, you know, having a history of prostitution, maybe drug abuse, anything that's deemed undesirable by the public and by society. And you know, they went to the argument, and the prosecutors even said this, that, you know, Holzclaw picked these women because the assumption was that they wouldn't tell because no one would believe them. Now, y'all hear me on this. This is two things. It's not they wouldn't tell, but he knew or he felt like no one would believe them by virtue of the fact that they were black women with histories. And as it turns out, a woman went and told, they believed her, and the ball got rolling. Now, we all know, I think most of us have seen the videos of when he was convicted and he learned that he was recommended to receive 263 years for his deeds, his dirty deeds. He started to break down and cry in the courtroom. And I think it was his birthday.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it was his birthday too. So, you know, my immediate reaction is, why are you crying now?
That was all about a thing. Like, man, what the hell you crying
for? What you crying for? You out here.
You did it.
Like, what I say earlier, you out here raping people.
You out here raping. You out here raping.
Yeah. It's like, let's not pretend it ain't what it is. You out here violating people on the regular. Like, that's your normal MO. So now you go to jail for that. You got caught doing it. But, you know, on one hand, it's good to know that these women are receiving justice. It's good to know that there are women who were victimized by this dude who can say he got what he deserved. He's going to jail. He's off the street. Someone hurt me. Someone believed me. Someone did something about it. But to me, it goes to a larger issue that, hear me now, only half of the charges were... He was forced to answer for only half of those charges. He was convicted on 18 of the 36 charges. So, 36. And then it was a lot going on in the news, and this thing wasn't covered as much as it should have been. But what was going on, and we knew about, was it was an all white jury,
and that had me nervous. Honestly, because I think we talked a little bit about that on the last episode. I was worried about the poor representation. Or the diversity in that jury, because, like, you know, the wrong story or the wrong presentation, you know, they very well could have sided with the policeman, as they've historically done. So that had me real nervous.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, but the thing is, it's like you were able to only get this dude convicted of 18 of the 36, even though they had his cruiser GPS, they had all types of physical evidence. And then when you get to 13 women, come on, you know, there, you know, we talked about this before, you know, Miss Liggins, you know, the one who got the ball rolling, you know, she spoke out right after the conviction, and, you know, she talked about what she had been through and what she had to endure going through, you know, one, the encounter with him, and then after the fact. But there was also a 17-year-old minor who was one of the 13. And she was asked some question by the press, but what it came down to is she pretty much said, who polices the police? Like, why would I tell? Because no one's going to police the police. So, and what do they say? Out of the mouths of babes, it's just the truth. But, you know, like I said, this dude is convicted. He's going to jail, you know, 263 years. Hopefully he lives the entire time while he's in jail. And he gets what he deserves. But, you know, it got me to thinking about the ideal of respectability politics and how it applies to black women and how we're seen and how we're treated. And one of the biggest issues I had hearing about this case was you have these women who are being violated, who have been violated, but their lives don't matter because they have, one might have a drug habit. One might be a prostitute. One might be something that's undesirable, but their lives were not going to be acknowledged. It's something to be protected, even though it's supposed to be protected under the law. You can break a law and still be protected by the law. That's what it's supposed to be.
That's what it'd be. Yeah.
And you know, and this overarching thing for me is our role in this world as a black woman is so shaky. On one hand, I birthed this world. I gave you life. But so how dare you turn around and tell me that you hate me and you teach everybody else around you to hate me? I gave you life. So, like, this is one little side note I'm gonna put out there. There is this thing going on right now, and I'm not going into great detail about it, but we're in a state of what they call the return of the mother. And, you know, look it up, you'll get it, but black women understand it. The return of the mother, things are changing. People are starting to open their eyes. Women are starting to stand up and make changes in their own personal lives to empower others around them, which goes to what I was kind of getting at is, like, you know, this respectability politics. Like, I don't deserve respect because I choose to wear fewer clothes. I don't deserve respect because I choose to focus on my career. I don't deserve respect because I choose to not have children, or I choose to have children and I can say I am not the kind of person that needs to be a primary parent. You know, that label makes me less worthy.
This is very reminiscent of slavery. They beat, kill, emasculate the male representation of the black community and rape the women. So we've got these two extremes that have been presented to us by our police. That's a terrible place to be in when an employee of the city or whatever you want to say is preying on people in one extreme or the next. You in a community, you're working in this community, and you're preying on, like, you're out here looking for a potential person to rape. And this cat was so bad that he was doing this multiple times per day.
Mm-hmm.
It's terrible. But that just came to me as you were talking about it, and we're talking about the respectability and how for so long it's been this thing, this whole lack of respect and not acknowledge her strength and her beauty and all that type of stuff.
I mean, it's what it comes down to is, think about it like this. That hashtag Black Lives Matter that everybody loves so much.
Right.
Who founded that?
Women.
Three black women.
They did.
Three black women created the movement of our generation. That's what it comes down to. But, you know, they'll get drugged. They'll be... because I think that they're all queer black women, you know, and people look at that like, oh, okay, well, it's not, it doesn't mean anything. Like, in every movement, there's this sense of misogyny that we are told what we're supposed to accept. Cause you know, I'm a fan of the vanguard of the movement, the Black Panther Party. And respect the programming and the things that they set up. But there has always been this underlying issue of misogyny within these movements. One book I would recommend the world to read is A Taste of Power by Elaine Brown. Elaine Brown was the only female chairman of the Black Panther Party. She was intimately involved with Huey P. Newton. When he was sent to jail, she was the one that stepped in and took charge. Mm-hmm. She was the one that was making the movement go, but she was getting mistreated. At the same time, Kathleen Cleaver, you know, we all know about Eldridge Cleaver and Kathleen Cleaver. She was being mistreated. You know, it's just that it's a part of it. Moringa, Kalawa Moringa, we all know about Kwanzaa. For the record, people, I don't celebrate Kwanzaa because he has had a history of mistreatment of people, period, but women in particular. So it's just this ideal that this misogyny and... mistreatment of the black woman is something that's to be expected. We are told we're supposed to be the mule of the world. You know what old people say? The mule of the world.
Simone, I ain't never heard that one.
You ain't never heard that?
No, I missed that one, Simone.
Yeah. Okay, you from Selma. You should have heard that one.
It's a lot of stuff. It's a lot of little old sayings that I do know, but that one missed me right now.
Yeah.
The mule of the world. So that means that you carry the grunt of the work of the world?
Yeah. Carry the weight of the world on your back. And like I said, we literally give birth to this world and then shit on by the same world. And it can come in the form of our own men, our own people. It can be in the form of people who are not a part of our culture. It can be anybody. You know, there are these caricatures of how black women are supposed to be. And, you know, it's really hard. You know, this kind of just came to me. You remember how when we were younger, when Madonna was popular.
Right.
And we all know Madonna is a white woman who was known for changing up her look all the time, being very sexually aggressive, progressive, provocative, controversial, kind of, I would even say like the white female counterpart to Prince. Because, you know, Prince was kind of pushing the envelope and all that.
All the time. All the time.
Yeah, and so she was the same way, which, you know, fast forward, she still does it a little bit, which I think it misses this generation because they just don't know, like, the background with her. Like with her, it comes across as just she's just being a fool, but that's kind of her MO. She's been doing this for years. Anyway, she has been a respected businesswoman. She has been a respected person in the entertainment industry. People put up with her nuttiness or whatever it is because she is progressive. She pushes she was considered someone that pushes entertainment and visuals forward by being risque. Grace Jones was doing that for how long before?
Well before.
What do we hear about that?
I wonder, you know, how many people, well, I'm sure probably most of our folks on this particular podcast would be somewhat familiar with Grace Jones, but nobody past us probably has an idea of Grace Jones and how she was like out there and was just doing things that people couldn't even imagine. You have this line and you have people caught up in the same situations. If we just want to draw a line and make it a white side and a black side, white female, black female side, draw that line. Similar issues, similar things happen to them. The sisters don't get any type of recourse or any acknowledgement of their place. And if we just talk about, for me, we talked about this too, just from the outside, not even dealing with it from a female perspective, but just as like me looking at this case and it being a man raping a woman in this particular situation. And I just noted how there was nothing about it.
Nope.
I mean, that you couldn't hardly find it. Like even today, you kind of have a hard time finding information on what has transpired. You can't find anything on this. Now, to me, this would be something that would be trumpeted in every type of form of fashion, because not only do you have a man that has basically been a serial rapist, not only do you have that, but you've also got a serial rapist that is doing this on the job as a policeman. Now, if that's not news, if that's not something that the people need to know about, why do we spend so much time talking about Bill Cosby?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We say Bill Cosby was a serial rapist and it was everywhere. Everybody was talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
30 years ago, you know, some of the instances. And then we have this right in front of our face and you can't find nothing on it.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that?
Because the thing is, they both should have been blown up.
Definitely.
They both should have been blown up. But, you know, this is a historical thing. This is a, you know, you have your well-meaning people who don't see themselves as any kind of misogynist, racist, whatever. But, you know, you look at, you know about Henrietta Lacks, right?
Sure, yep.
Yeah, that's a perfect example. Henrietta Lacks was a poor black woman in Baltimore who had, was it cervical cancer?
I think it was something uterine or cervical, something with the
reproductive. Yeah, it was some reproductive. And I'm ashamed to say I can't remember which one it is because I read the book. But, you know, there was a doctor who took some of her cells and her cells still live to this day. And it saved millions and millions of lives. And her family is just now getting any sort of compensation for it. But more than that, she was being used for experimentation and didn't even know. And there has always been this sense that a black woman's body is just, is open season on a black woman's body. Any black woman's body is there for you to give life to somebody else in some way, shape or form. You know, like the irony of having such hate. And I'm thinking about during a time where our folks were enslaved, you know, black women serving as nursemaids to white babies. Being the main one to take care of a white person's child, feeding them, clothing them, teaching them about life, taking care of them, giving them life, helping them to survive life, receiving love and all of that. That is something that is an expectation of a black woman. A black woman is expected to give it. And if it's not given, it's taken. Mm. Look at this cop. He was entitled. He felt completely entitled to do that to a number of black women. And he was a serial rapist. But I sort of feel like it turns out he was a serial rapist by definition, but he wasn't going to be serially raping no white girls. He wasn't going to do that because he would have been doing it. And this is a historical thing too. It goes back to, have you ever read Soul on Ice? By Eldridge Cleaver. One of the most disturbing things about that story of his, that, you know, we all wrap it up and make it seem like, oh, he was a part of the revolution and this was just his story or whatever, whatever. One of the main things he said when he was in prison, he was going through his transition. He went to prison because he was raping white girls. But what he was doing was practicing on black women. And he said it that way. He practiced on black women because he knew no one would care. No one would do anything about it. And that is a mentality that has yet to die. It's a mentality that has not done anything other than morph and become worse. Mm-hmm. Yet and still, man, we live in this. We got to do shit like Stay Mad Abby hashtags. You know, we have to wear our caps and gowns with all of our honors and all of our accomplishments to push forward our worth, because you have people like this Abby person who is entitled, because you have this cop who is entitled. You have this Scalia who is entitled to feel like they can say and do whatever it is that they want to do on the black body. So what it comes down to for me is, you can't be no punk to be a black woman, not in this world. And we are in a stage, sisters, and I'm this is something I'm putting out there. It's like, it's time to like get your weight up, because this is not about to get any easier. You know what I mean? It's not about to become something that's just going to dissipate because you have a conviction. It's not going to dissipate because you have hashtags. It's not going to dissipate because, you know, you can assert your earning power. You can be a great mother. You can be a great this. You can be a great that. We have hundreds and hundreds of years that we have to work through, and we're still trying to get through them. So, you know, my biggest thing as a woman, specifically as a black woman, is that we are entitled to be whoever we're going to be. And we are entitled to being able to say, all right, I can be, what is it, the lady in the streets, freaking the sheets. You push that out there. No, I am every woman. The greatest song ever made was Chaka Khan's I'm Every Woman. As corny as that song may be, it may be, you know, something that people are like, they just kind of dismiss it. That's the greatest thing that a black woman could have ever said, because we have been called to be so many things to so many people. We have been called to be everything to everybody. And at some point, we need to have a chance to say, yeah, I did that. I can do that.
Just over the last course of, say, this year and a year and a half, and I don't know if it's in relationship to us just opening up this medium to invite in a different type of energy and positivity, but in this span of time, like, I have encountered some phenomenal young women, like women that have a passion, a purpose, and they just have that fire and that spirit that you can't do anything but embrace and appreciate. And then in having those experiences is heightened my awareness to, as we move into this next phase of our lives, being 30 somethings, that there is nothing that I can do. If we're talking about like impactful change and having influence, there's nothing that I can do without having, you know, a black woman in that equation, because there is a certain skill set. There's a certain delivery. There's just these attributes that you all possess that brings about this completion. So I guess with that and everything that you said, when you look at, we'll just talk about me and who I represent. When you look at the black male, what is it that you would say that in your position, what do you need from us? Like, what can we bring to the table to edify what you have going on?
First off, don't get mad when we say we don't need you for certain things. Real talk.
Okay.
And I say that with a whole lot of love, because I, you know, I've said this before, I don't identify as a feminist, I identify as a womanist. And as a womanist, it is equality on all levels, but also recognizing the power and the necessity of the black man to the family. So, and from a family unit. But when I can say, hey, I got my lane, I know what I'm doing, I know what I need to do to empower myself so that I can empower you, and by default, the nation, you know, don't take that as, oh, you another black woman trying to tear brothers down and blah, you know how it goes to, it can go to that level. But the flip side of that is when I say I need you, or when I say I need you to lean in to supporting me developing individually, please do that. You know, that, and what it comes down to, and it's different for everyone, but it can come down to just not giving me a hard time if I don't want to have children. You know what I mean? Or don't give me a hard time if I want to have a lot of children. Right. You know, it's like just be honest. That's one of the biggest things. It's like being honest about what the expectation is, but still being able to see that, just like, let me put it this way. There's a reason that women are known multitaskers. We are known to be able to handle and juggle a lot of things. True. Acknowledge the fact that is a real superpower. And sometimes, it's not going to be perfect. It's not going to be as planned. It's not going to be right. But still know that we possess that superpower no matter how it presents itself. And it's a necessity to the world being here. But like I said earlier when I kind of was on my tangent, is don't ask me to birth your world. Don't ask me to nurture and develop your world. And then you turn around and you tell the products of my womb to shit on me. And tell the products of my creativity to disregard me.
Hmm.
So
that's true. That's true. There's one other, I guess, question that I would have. Mm-hmm. And what is your take on the response of these identified nationally renowned feminist group or women support groups and their response to this case like this? Because I really haven't seen anything from any of those big organizations, those organizations that were speaking out against Bill Cosby during that whole thing. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen much come from them. Have you?
No, you ain't gonna see nothing come from them. This ain't their cause. You know, what's the Sojourner Truth? And Ain't I a Woman? Mm-hmm. There you go. Look it up, people. Like, it's that is an exclusive club. That is an exclusive club that really doesn't want to have anything to do with that grandma in Oklahoma who was sexually assaulted. That 17-year-old girl, or that, like I said, that drug addict or whatever. They're not going to jump onto that. They're not going to get onto that, because the first thing that comes to mind is that these are black women. So the blackness is going to make us unentitled, them unentitled to that same support. So it's not surprising. Black women have been thrown under the bus for an eternity.
And even in being on the front line of pushing and fighting for some of these things, i.e., this girl talking about affirmative action and fighting against the amendments that are put in place, that had to be put in place to ensure equality for black folks. Mm-hmm. And then you come down the road, now you trying to use that to push your call. Like, man, our folks died for that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Because those provisions were not in place prior to them dying for it and fighting for it.
Mm-hmm.
So even the feminists, you know, some of the feminist movement, and my acquaintance to the whole feminist thing has been on the back of people that I know, people that I relate to, speaking out for some of the, I guess, items that would be on the the agenda for that particular movement. Like, I don't know. No, but, white feminists.
But I mean, and the thing is, like, one of the most prominent black feminists, who is one of my favorite people, is Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. I always say her name wrong, but you know, she wrote Americana. Yeah, Half of a Yellow Sun, Purple Hibiscus, and We Should All Be Feminists. Like, that's what she's known for, that TED Talk. So, you know, if you like Beyonce, and that song Flawless, that's her voice, that's her from her TED Talk. And, you know, that thing around your neck, like, she's written some powerful stuff, and it's very, you know, I think just recently you're saying every 16-year-old in Sweden is going to be, is reading, is required to read, or they're going to give every 16-year-old that thing around your neck, I believe. Or, no, We Should All Be Feminists. That's the one that they're going to give. So the TED Talk. So the impact that she makes is, she is a woman of color. She's a black woman. She's an African woman. She's a Nigerian American woman. And she has been giving that movement a boost and a push into pop culture. But that movement is not going to say anything about these women.
That's sad. That's so sad.
But it's the reality of what it is.
It definitely is.
Yeah.
And it's once again, it's one of those things. And for me, as a black man, and you talked about it, family and reestablishing that center of us working together. Like, we as men, we do have a role in protecting, for sure. Protecting what our sisters have going on, and then building on it and facilitating, or whatever we need to do in support of, and because we undoubtedly get the support back. Even when we jackasses, we get support. I know that for sure. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we're gonna play a large role into, if nothing else, framing the way that our next generations view and stand up for. Black women.
And the thing is, there just needs to be the shame needs to be removed from us saying that we need black men. You know, like I said earlier, it's like, don't get mad if I say I don't need you for something. But that's more in a very, that's a very specific tone, specific individual thing. But just in general, it's like, don't make us feel ashamed for saying we need you, or we want you to do better, or we can't do certain things on our own. It's all about balance.
Balance is the key. Sorry. Balance is the key. All right, so there you have it. And we're going to give you some information. So if you got comments, you like what we said, or something that we should have said that we didn't say, we'll give you an opportunity to hit us up and let us know what you think. But at this time, Simone, it's time for that feather drop. You got one for us?
Yeah, it's real simple today. It's one of my favorites. I say it on a regular basis, but it is, I am not in competition with the next woman. I am in service of her. So if you are a woman and there's another woman that you love, it could be your mama, or it could be your sister or your friend, be in service. Keep a mentality of, you know, I'm here to help. I'm here to assist. We are all trying to get to someplace safe, happy, peaceful, whatever that is. And my role as a woman to another woman is to assist. So that's the feather drop.
And there you got it from the Shy Peacock, Simone Jones. Simone, how can the people get in contact you for them, for some more of that type of stuff? Because you got plenty. You got plenty to say. You've put a lot of stuff out there. So how can the people get a hold of that?
You can hit me on Instagram at The Shy Peacock, Facebook, The Shy Peacock, or you can go directly to my site at theshypeacock.com. That's it.
I think we covered everything. I am BG the 27 Kid. This is a Retroscope podcast, a part of the New South Movement Network. Feel free to look for us. We're on iTunes, New South Movement Network. If you go there, you get access to all of the podcasts in our family. This one, the Retroscope, Free Lunch Podcast, D1 Sport Talk Podcast, and the Girl Talk Podcast. All right there in one place. Also, check for us on Instagram. We're the Retroscope Podcast. And just let us know what you think. Give us some commentary, some comments, and let us know if there's something you want us to talk about. Feel free to drop us a line. Until next week, we are out of here. Peace out.
Peace.
You can call it, but you can't use my phone.